Thank you. and the mic came in. Okay. We'd like to welcome all of you here this afternoon and thank you all for making it the tremendous effort to make today's reunion the success that it is. Later on, we'll find out where everybody came from and we will see how remarkable this family unit has spread, and yet today shows a sign of the closeness that was started many, many years ago by the Joy family. And it's a tradition, and I'd like to invite Uncle Steve Joy to come up, please, and say grace for the family today.
Well, friends, relatives,
countrymen.
I hope I'm not the oldest here, but I think I'm next to the oldest. Joe Perito, I think, beats me. All right, now we're ready to say grace. Okay. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Bless us, O Lord, and these are gifts which we are about to receive from thy bounty.
Thank you.
Summertime. Documenting the history. We had one from Egypt, Ted Hope. Hooray!
Oh, four flowers for the guy. Sorry. I'll give him a kiss. Where is he?
And Steve, we have something very special for Aunt Madeline, because she's always, boy, whenever something originates in this family, you can always ask Aunt Madeline to do her thing too. So that's for Aunt Madeline and for helping us bake for the sweets table. We have to. And we have Uncle Sal, we'd like to present you two with a boutonniere, if you'd like to come up. We want a sure thing when, you know, the next time your horse is running. We want a hot tip. Anyway, put it on him. Anyway, that's for you. That's a boutonniere for you. Like to call on Aunt Carolyn Conroes to carry on with the program festivities. And that great one and only, let's give her a big hand, a big round of applause, Aunt Carolyn.
Anything. Good. didn't do it. Joy to you all. This is our family tree. This is our family tree. Alive, flourishing, and growing. And it even has the bluebird of happiness in it. This reading of the Joy family history may take an hour or more. So for anyone who has weak kidneys, please go to the John now. I don't want anyone to leave this room while I'm here. On February 16th, I received a letter from the committee of this great Joy reunion. I was excited, elated, and happy until I read, "And Carolyn has been commissioned to be official historian." No one asked for my permission. I'm the youngest of the clan, except for my brother Sal. How do I know about family history? My older brothers and sisters more know about our family background than I do. They are much, much older. Maybe they chose me because I am the nuttiest one of the family. And I don't know how to say no. That's why I got my husband. I couldn't say no when he proposed to me. Some of you nieces, nephews, and grandchildren didn't have the wonderful opportunity of knowing those two wonderful people who were responsible for all of us being here today. I'm still just... You're still giving me action. So I'll just give you the background of how the Joyce family came to be. Luigi Gioia was born in Valdadomo, Sicily.
Hey, that's not a bad idea. Oh.
Okay. Luigi Gioia was born in Valdadomo, Sicily, on November 8, 1866. His father was Carl Gioia. His mother was Antonia Catalina Gioia. Our father had three brothers, Anthony, Joseph, and Salvatore, and three sisters, Angela, Francisca, and Madalena. Our father's grandfather, the first Louis Gioia, was born in 1778, died at the age of 97. Our father's father was born in 1840, died in 1916 at age 76. His mother was born in 1859, died in 1894 at the age of 44. Besides our father, only his brother Joseph came to America. His younger brother, Salvatore, was lost at sea while returning home from war. Our father had an uncle, his father's brother, who lived in Buffalo, New York. Our father had a burning desire to make his future life in America. So he wrote to his uncle asking for $200 to pay for his passage to America. His uncle sent him the money, but unfortunately, the letter was intercepted by his father, who kept the money, not wanting his son to leave. Our father was heartbroken, so he wrote to his uncle again, explaining what had happened, and asked him to send another $200, but to a different address, promising that when he came to America, he would pay him the $400. His uncle did send him the money. So, in March 1890, at the age of 24, he sailed from Palermo, Sicily, and arrived in Buffalo in April to live with his uncle Frank Gioia. He found a job laying streetcar tracks and was able to pay back the money his uncle had given him. While living with his uncle, he met his uncle's wife's sister's daughter, Louise Castellone. Louise Castellone, our mother, was born on June 6, 1878, to Teresa and Stephen Castellone. She was the eldest in her family. She had a sister, Carrie, two brothers, Anthony and Samuel. Our father fell in love with Louise and asked permission to marry her. And so on February 20th, 1894, our parents were married. Our mother was 15, our father was 27. They lived in Buffalo where their first child was born, a son, Carl, who died a few months later. Our mother never forgot the heartbreak of losing her firstborn. Our sisters, Anne and Teresa, were also born in Buffalo. Okay. Later, when our mother's parents bought property in Fredonia, New York, our mother was saddened and lonesome for her parents. During the time she lived in Buffalo, her younger sister, Carrie, was married to Cosimo Rodico, and both daughters missed their parents. Our father and his brother-in-law, Cosimo, decided to move near their wife's parents. Two sisters in their families moved in with their parents while sister Mildred was born. Luigi and Cosimo bought a house in Arkwright, lived together and worked on the land, but the profits from farming were not sufficient to maintain two families. One year it was drought, another year it was crops underwater, picking beans in their bare feet. It was hard work with no profit. So in 1901, our parents moved closer to the town of Fredonia. They bought a house and 12 acres of land at 115 Lakeview Avenue. Our mother's sister and her husband also bought a house and acreage close to ours, both near their parents. In this home, Carl, Steve, and I were born. On July 4th, 1915, our father took his three daughters to Niagara Falls. Our mother remained home with Carl, Steve, and me. She was baking bread when the chimney became overheated and the house caught on fire. Our mother took her three children out of the house safely, then ran back into the picture of her firstborn. After much pulling and struggling, with a danger of being burned to death, she finally pulled it down from the wall and came out. Before the fire department arrived, our house was burned to the ground. When our father arrived, he was devastated, but happy to know his family was safe. So in 1916, he rebuilt a brick house on the same site where our brother Sal was born.
Okay.
Let me explain to you how the Joy name came to be from Joya. Incidentally, our father was a second cousin to the Joya and Bravo Macaroni Company, which originated in Fredonia. When our father had to translate business, no one could pronounce Joya. Also, he had a cousin living in the nearby town who had the same name as our father. This cousin ran up a lot of bills, and some of these were owed to our father. Not wanting to jeopardize his credit rating, he decided to anglicize the name of Joya. Joy, who we are descendants of, Louis Joy. Our father worked for a plumbing company as a tinsmith in Fredonia. Later for the American Locomotive Company in Dunkirk, a town joining Fredonia. In addition to working at his trade, he farmed the 12 acres of land, selling grapes, berries, tomatoes to canning factories, as well as raising the kind of fruits and vegetables to feed his family. Our father was a self-taught man. He learned to read and write both Italian and English. He was always interested in nature, history, and science. He loved to read. In fact, because he enjoyed reading so much, he was nicknamed, in Italian, Librino. one who loves to read. He was greatly respected by the townspeople and was always addressed to Sir Luigi, a title of honor, and we are proud of him. He gave us a wonderful heritage. Our dear mother worked hard, raising 7 children, maintaining a 10-room house, washing clothes by hand, saving nothing but loaves of iron each week, and besides baking several loaves of bread twice a week. Then each day she had to prepare meals for 9 people, each working. Besides getting breakfast, she would have to pack lunches, those who went to work as well as those who went to school. At harvest time, she was always there. Then it was time to can all the vegetables and fruits for winter. It was always a long, hard day for her, but she never complained, always with a smile. And she was a softie. She never spanked us. She left that up to Dad. I think some of you can still feel his strap. Not really. He didn't hit that hard. Only hard enough to discipline us and keep us on the right track. Unfortunately, our mother could not read nor write, but she had a creative mind. Without recipes, she would make the most delicious fruit pies every Saturday. My brothers Carol and Steve would attest to this, that they would devour a whole pie between them. She was always made the best pizza, cookies at Easter time, and of course, the Christmas cookies by the dozen. But she will always be remembered for her famous Mama Louisa's cookies. Which no one of the sisters, I don't think, has been able to duplicate. We'll see. Too elderly to maintain it and the farm, we convinced them to sell and move to Rochester, where their children had settled. So our homestead was such wonderful memories was sold, and our parents joined us. We all have happy memories of yearly family picnics at Ellison Park. What fun getting together for birthdays, anniversaries, holidays, and Christmas. We loved our parents, and they loved and we're proud of each one of their offspring. I'm sure they know they had done a wonderful job raising us. Our mother left us in May 1964 at the age of 86. Our father wanted to live long enough to take care of her, but after she left, he felt his life was over too. So he left us a year later in June 1965 at the age of 98. He would have reached 99 in 5 months. I have given you a brief history of our background. Incidentally, I called, Italian Embassy. And they said that they didn't have anything in a small town like Bragolomo. It would be like someone asking about Webster and East Rochester. So, that's it. I have given you a brief history of our background. Now I'm going to get down to the nitty gritty of your parents and grandparents, your nieces, nephews, and grandchildren. I'll start off with the eldest of the Joy clan. Ann Ann. She was our second mother. She made all the dresses for us girls. She would do the spring and fall cleaning in our big house. She knitted, tatted, sewed, embroidered, you name it, and she did it. Ann made the most delicious coconut cream, chocolate pies, and of course our favorite lemon pie. When we went on trips to Rochester, she would lay all the men's clothes out on the dining room table, ready for them to jump into the next morning. She tended to each of us like a mother. Her talents are unlimited. She played the piano. And on Saturday nights, our cousins, the Ladigos, would come to our house. She would play the piano, and we would gather around and sing the latest songs. Then it was party time, eating her delicious pies. Besides all her work she did at home, she worked a while at the Red Wing Canning Company. After she married Ralph, she came to Rochester. Our parents lived with her, and she took care of them until they left us. Anne is still our second mother. She remembers and sends cards to each of us at all special occasions. She has spent many months in the hospital, never complaining. But in spite of all her setbacks, aches and pains, she has spent many hours creating gifts to give to those she loves. Right. Next is our sister, Teresa. In our home, we had a formal dining room. In this room was an organ. This living room was more or less isolated from the rest of the living area. Teresa had a sweet tooth, and on her way back from school, she would buy a bag of penny candy. Then on the pretext of playing the organ, she would unwrap the candy. Unwrap the candy. Wait a minute. I gotta find my place. Unwrap the candy. Of course, no one could hear the noise of the wrapper. She played loudly and munched on the candy until it was gone. Teresa, does that account for all the fillings in your teeth today? On our property, we had a natural spring well with a quicksand bottle. One day, Teresa and Anne were playing near the well. Teresa had a doll and decided to give her doll a drink of water. When she dipped the doll in, she lost her balance and went in head first. When Anne saw two legs sticking out of the well, thank God she had presence of mind to pull those up, or else Teresa's children, Anne Marie, Joe, Lois, and grandchildren would not be here today. Ask your mother about that scar over her right eye. Teresa was very efficient basket maker for a small baskets company in Fredonia. She was the only one working in that little shack, and every day she would excel the number of baskets she had made the previous day. With tacks in her mouth and a little hammer, which I think she still has, she would whirl away like a little old shoemaker. But it was tiresome standing all day. So when we finished dinner at night, Teresa would turn her back to the back of the chair, put her head down in her folded arm, and fall right to sleep. I think it was her way of getting away of doing the dishes. When it came to help during the grape season, it was a different story. The grapes are picked in crates. Teresa and Mildred were supposed to help pack the grapes into baskets so they could be taken to market. One day our father came home and found that Teresa and Mildred had not done that. They had disobeyed him, so he ordered them to sleep in the barn near the house without any supper to teach them to obey and not play. Tearfully, they climbed to the loft. Yes, that was the night our mother didn't sleep a wink. She sat up in the window watching that barn all night long. After she married Joe Pareto, they lived in Rochester. She worked for a time at Neisner Brothers, a 5 and 10 cent store. Later, for Hickok Company, making leather goods, when she retired to raise her family. Next comes our sister, Mildred. One day our father discovered some mice in our basement, so he set a trap for them with a piece of cheese. Mildred wanted to know just how the mice would get the cheese, so she got down on all fours and tried to get the cheese. Snap! went the track. She couldn't scream, so in pain she went up to her mother with a trap sealing her lips. I think the pain comes from the thought and frustration that she couldn't talk. Not able to talk? Catastrophic. Bill, I'm kidding. As a young girl, she worked in a drugstore. Every night after school, I would stop in and she would make the biggest, most delicious Mexican sundaes. Now you know why I am so pleasantly tall. Mildred was the party girl. We always had parties at our house. I can still taste the minced ham sandwiches. Mildred is responsible for all of us coming to Rochester. We followed her, but then she left for a warmer climate and to be with her daughter, Marie Grace, and son Joe, and to get a lot of talk. She still has a daughter living here, Luniante. We had a cousin in Fredonia who was dating a Joe Patel of Rochester. On one occasion, when he went to Fredonia, this cousin asked Mildred to her house to meet her boyfriend. Well, when he set eyes on Mildred, he fell in love at first sight. The following day, Mildred invited them to our house, supposedly to pick cherries. Mildred and Joe climbed the ladder together to pick cherries. Well, they never came down from that lofty height in their love for each other, and so they were married and lived in Rochester. She started the migration, followed by Teresa. And then there remained five. After I graduated from high school, I also came to Rochester to go to college, and I lived with Mildred. There I met a lovely girl named Madeline Jenko. I thought she made a wonderful wife for my brother Carl, so I arranged for these to meet. It worked out as I had hoped, and we now have the Angelos, Sauders, McGill family. Carl was the hard-working one. He helped their father on the farm as well as working for a local lumber company. He worked hard, long hours, and at night, he would be so tired to climb the stairs to bed, he would lie down on the landing, flat on his back, and fall sound asleep. Anyone wanting to climb the stairs would have to step over him. Our mother would finally have to rouse him to go to bed. When Carl dressed to go out for an evening, he would put on his hat first, then sit down and put on his socks and shoes. We got a big kick out of that. On Saturday nights, Carl and Steve would walk to town to the local pool hall where all the young men gathered for a big night on the town. Carl bought a Victrola for our parents, and every Saturday night he would buy a new hit record. We all looked forward to that. After Carl and Madeline were married, our father gave them a piece of land and they built a home next to our family house. Madeline worked in the silk mill in Dunkirk. Carl continued to work for Zaloff as well as working on the farm. Lou and Jerry were born in that warm and cozy home. When our parents sold our home, so did Carl and Madeline and bought a home in Rochester. Carl began to work for the New York Central Railroad, and Madeline worked for the Bond Clothing Company. They both retired from their jobs and built a new home in Ogden, where they are now living and where Carl is still working hard on his house, lawn, and vegetable garden in summer. Yay. Now for our brother Steve, the politician. Before he became involved in politics and a lawyer, he was a diplomat and a politician. As a young man at home, for when it was berry picking time, Steve would rust us all out of bed early in the morning and say, "Let's get up and get those berries picked before it gets too hot." So we'd get up, put on our straw hats, put our baskets around our waist, and march to the berry patch. working diligently in the hot sun. After a while, we would look around. Where's Steve? Where's Steve? Nowhere to be found. But he was tapped in diplomacy. He managed to get us to pick the berries. We had a cow who had to be milked every day. One day I went to the barn where Steve was milking the cow. She said to me, Harold, open your mouth. I bet I could squirt the milk right into your mouth. Being younger and obedient, I opened my mouth. He never hit it. Especially, he never hit a squirrel. That is when I got my first milk facial. And why I have such a gorgeous, silky complexion. Steve played the violin, and when still in high school, he formed a band, and rehearsals were held at our house. Those nights, we either stuffed our ears with cotton or left the house. His talent was evident, so he went to the Eastman School of Music to further his musical ability. He played the violin, but Steve never fiddled around. In our house, we had a coal-burning furnace, and it was Steve and Kyle's responsibility to take out the ashes, which, of course, created a lot of dust. One day, while they were doing this, I wandered down and saw my two brothers experimenting with a cigarette. When they saw me, they almost swallowed us and threatened me not to tell our father or else, but they never smoked again. I guess they must have turned green after that. After graduating from high school, Steve attended Canisius College in Buffalo and in 1931 graduated from Buffalo Law School. After graduation, he came to Rochester, where he passed the bar examination and set up his practice. That was when he met Mary Battetti. She worked for Siebert Stoves. And after I graduated from RBI, she found me a job there, too. Mary and I had a very close relationship, and I was happy when she married our brother, Steve. She gave him a very happy life, Stephanie, Steve Jr., and Alberta. As I mentioned before, Steve was always a politician and interested in politics and his Democratic Party. In 1936, he was elected assemblyman and went to Albany. What a great honor for our Joy family. When President Kennedy took office, he appointed Steve U.S. Magistrate, another feather in his cap. Steve has had his own law practice for many years. Early this year, I asked him when he was going to retire. He said, I think this June. I was glad. He had worked hard at this long enough. But at the last conversation I had with him was, well, I still go to the office. Still, Steve, when are you going to retire and relax? Our baby brother, Sal. He was the tallest one in the family, but he was our baby and our toy. We all doted on him. He was the cutest little boy who had his picture taken on a pony. Now he plays with a pony. Picture taken on a pony in front of our house by a professional photographer. I can still see that picture before me and that cute smile on Sal's face, the smile he still has. Being the youngest, Sal got all the toys for Christmas, a rocking horse, sled, ice skates, which we never got. Cars, a lot of things which we never got. I guess Sam will like you better.
You left out Carolyn.
Are you the last one?
I don't think so.
In high school, he played drums in the high school band. I can still see him dressed in uniform, hat on, the black and gold cap over his shoulders. Musically inclined even then, for now he plays the accordion and the organ. And see, Sam, when you were a kid, you got a picture on the horse, got horses. You played the accordion, you played the drums, follows you right up to your age now, all those talents.
I'm not going to stop for the horse. No.
Lucky we have him here today. For one day, when he was driving the horse and wagon down Lakeview Avenue, the horse bulged, upturning the wagon and pinning Sal between the wagon and the hill alongside the road. Thank God he wasn't hurt. Sal served in the Navy, married, and has three children, Louis, Dennis, and Mary Ellen. While living in Buffalo for a while with his family, he owned his own barber shop, another one of his talents. Being a good barber, period.
Very
But his talents don't end in hair cutting, organ, accordion, playing alone. There isn't anything Sal can't build or do. We are all familiar with one of the Surreys he built all by himself for his ponies to pull. He's received many awards for his ponies and Surrey in many of the parades he has participated in. From a plain piece of land in Leroy, Sal and his wife Doris together built a beautiful estate. We are all familiar with the beautiful regulation-sized tennis court Sal built, the fireplace, the huge barn, and of course the cottage, where we fond memories of picnics and a tad and sausage being broiled in the fireplace. Pony rides for the little ones. Sal is talented, warm, and big-hearted brother. Doris is his right arm. Without her love, support, and hard work, Sal would be lost. She has given him the love and center for what he has today. Thanks, Sal and Doris, for the good times we have had because of your warm hospitality and for all the vegetables and fruit, even though I hated shucking all those beans. Well,
you.
As President Reagan starts his sentences, I'm the only one left.
Right.
My life's history brief.
Oh, no.
I had a blind date with a handsome man who I fell deeply in love with and whom I still love deeply. Given us nine beautiful grandchildren. They have fulfilled my life and made me very happy. Sometimes I tell my husband, he gives me achito. When he irks me, how would you feel when you are sound asleep and he comes up and says, honey, get up, I want to show you something.
Tell me about heaven.
No. He comes up and awakens you in the middle of the night to join him in one of his gourmet Italian dishes that he's cooked up. Out of a sound sleep, I got to eat his macaroni with the peas and the garlic and the eggs and the cheese. Yes, he gives me achito, but I couldn't live without him. God bless this family, who originated from our wonderful Louis, Louise, Joy. We all share wonderful memories of our past and will always cherish them. Thank God we are still together, and if our parents were still alive, they would be proud of each of us and would say, we did a good job. Hey, I think I left out a page.
What about you?
Yes.
Sounded chronological.
Well, I can ad-lib.
good.
She's good. Anybody got to go to the bathroom, you better go now.
You in the folder, Kelly?
Yeah, I think I have it. Okay. Just a few minutes. I know you would like to congratulate Carl and Madeline on their 54th wedding anniversary.
Oh, bravo.
Also Bob and Sherry's daughters on their 19th. Stand up. Where's Bob?
Ben, you can either congratulate or offer sympathy to my husband, who has put up with me for 47 years. Together. It's sad that because of this jet age,
the third and fourth generations are so far apart and can enjoy such good times together as we elders remember so vividly. Thank you. God bless.
And Carolyn, you've done a tremendous job and a tremendous service to this family. I know you put a lot of time and effort into it, and I'm sure everyone here appreciates the time and love and research that went into it. So from the bottom of our hearts, you made this an outstanding occasion by all the work and time you did into it, and we love you and thank you so much for it.
Anne-Marie and family, if I did love you all so much, I would have said no right off the bat. But I was excited and anxious to do something about this and reminisce about the good times this family's had. I just wish that this family would be together forever.
I do.
Because
too.
It's a wonderful family. How many families this large could get together from all over the country?
That's true.
And I appreciate it. And thank you so much.
Thank you, Carolyn. We love you dearly.
I love you all.
She was always the special one. She could organize anything. When we had our family picnics as kids, that was the lady in charge of the games and the gimmicks and the ideas and everything. I'll tell you, if anything in this family was ever a success, because she was always behind it.
Right.
And it shows again today. And Carolyn, you just made it. Really, it was a marvelous presentation. Thank you again.
Thank you.
that the sound of your voice can get behind.
is the baddest one in town. But if you go down there, you better just beware of a man named Leroy Brown. Oh, Leroy's all the trouble. You see, he's been about 6'4". And all the downtown ladies on the tree topples over all the men they just can't serve. Yeah, but he's back, back, hey, Leroy Brown. The baddest man in this whole damn town. Badder than old King Kong. Man, he's meaner than the junkyard dog. Oh, Leroy, he's a gambler. And he likes his fancy clothes. But he likes to wear his diamond ring upon everybody's nose. Along he got the custom continental.
about it.
My love, there's only you in my life. The only thing that is right. My first love, you're every step that I make. You're every breath that I take.
we taped at the nursing home on Aunt Ann's birthday. I'm going to play it. Maybe you would like to hear it. Okay? It's a birthday party for Aunt Ann at the nursing home. Uncle Steve is participating with Uncle Sal and Uncle Carl. Okay, let's have your attention here. A little noise, we want it quiet. I have a tape here that I'd like to play. It was taken at the nursing home for Aunt Ann on her birthday, so you'd like to listen to this. Maybe that'll be the last chance you have to listen to it.
Jimmy!
Stephen Joy, Esquire, and the vocal chorus is by Sal Joy and his brother Carl Joy.
Today is my birthday, 88 years old. And I thought I was going to be by myself today because my sister called up and she had a cold. And I thought, and I told, called her up and I told her not to worry because I'll be just as glad and happy as ever. But my three brothers came over and surprised me, took pictures of me, and bought me a birthday cake. And I'm really happy. And also with me today is my birthday is Dolores, Healy, Evelyn, a friend of my neighbor, and Anna, and Barbara Dieter, a good friend of mine, and her daughter, I love her so much. And so I thank everybody, and may God bless you all, and what a happy birthday this has been. I never was so surprised.
Thank you. bananas.
Very good.
Sure, I'm speaking for everyone here that we want to thank and then congratulate the committee who has done a fantastic job in organizing this. They spent hours and hours. My son, Chuck, and his wife, Judy. My niece, Anne Marie, and her husband, Ike. My nephew, Steve, and his wife, Edwina, for putting hours in, time, money, etc. Also for all those that bake those delicious cookies. I know we're all very appreciative. I don't have to enumerate them. Everybody knows the aunts were delegated. But I'm sure that there were others, nieces, that did it too. Thank you very much to this wonderful committee. Without them, this would not have been come about. Thank you.
Mommy, catch some of that.
How's that?
Oh! That's gorgeous.
Oh, all right.
Cookies, cheese, bread and butter, whatever you want.
Well, I'll tell you, there's the first family.
Nice. Okay, everybody.
Get your iPod in a couple minutes because this is going to go on till after.
Grandchildren, then.
It's on.
And from beautiful downtown Van Nuys, California, here's Joey.
Miss the Saturday dance, heavy crowd at the floor. Couldn't bear it without you. Don't get around much anymore. But I visit the club, got as far as the door. Couldn't bear it without you. Don't get around much anymore. If I had gone, but what for? I'll be different without you. Don't get around much anymore. Stars shining bright. someday find you.
Thank you.
drums are built. And the bass drum is just going away.
Yeah, the bass drum is, you know?
Apples and carrots. Sharing dreams. Apples and carrots. So I have to leave now. I can't go around and say goodbye to everyone. So, Doris and I will say goodbye to everybody. We'll see you later.
That goes good.
Okay.
All right. A tripod. I'll just set it down.
Who wants $2 on the nose? $2.
Good luck with the horse, Sam.
Somebody's in the back, I don't see the face. There it is.
Who handed me this
thing?
With the horse.
Sharon
Dream. You gotta watch this horse.
Steve Joy, you ready for the next family?
Always ready. I see you ready.
All right. Ann Hildreth's family. You ready for Ann Hildreth's family?
I said I might have to repeat.
focus here.
Thank you. it still looks good, you know?
That's all you got is three? Three!
Thank you.
Hi, buddy.
Shelly, watch out.
Yes.
Mary Joy. Oh. Can't even read my own writing. The Perry.
I'm sorry.
Santa Claus.
I was just gonna say that. That's for Santa Claus. Scott McPerry.
Is there anything in there for Dennis Joy?
No. These are just for the elder nieces and nephews.
Ah.
Okay?
Okay.
Single one.
Dennis, come here.
These are the bad cheese.
You're a winner. Tapes available. How many do you have there? One or two or three?
Well, that's a girl about that.
Pardon?
It's a girl?
Yeah.
It's, she's the name that I've been.
Is there any young man?
Thank you.
Excuse me.
Emery, will you handle that situation?
I can't handle it. Mother, I'll see.
Jerry needs that. No, no. Yeah. Ralph.
Oh, we got one. We got one.
Teresa Pret all.
Don't worry about details, sir.
Which one you Lumianti? Amian. Steve? My brother Steve, where is he?
Dead. Yo, Steve Joyce. No, you.
Which one?
You're the brother.
Get off.
My sister Mildred.
You take her.
Mildred?
Can you get this off?
You're either going to be on Janet Carson or Joan Winters. Your sister, not me. He did it. Hey. Oh, thank you very much. You gotta hurry and get out. Okay?
Oh, yes.
In the year 8000 BC, music sounded something like this. In 1789, along came Mozart, and music sounded like this. Then in 1907, along came W.C. Handy, and jazz was born.